was Jason McCoy. He is this episode's guest on Guitar Players in Isolation. Jason is a member of the award-winning band The Roadhammers, and before that, he's had an impressive solo career, earning him many hits and a CMA award. I am thrilled to have this amazing guitarist, songwriter, and morning radio show host as my guest today. If you are returning to my channel, thanks so much for the support. And if you have not done so already, please subscribe, hit that bell notification button. This really helps the YouTube algorithm show my videos out so more people can see them. If you're new to my channel, this is my 17th interview, so lots of other amazing guests you can check after watching this one. And if you like this kind of stuff and have friends that you think will too, please share it on your socials. Get the word out. Anyway, let's get started. Hey, Jason, how are you?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Oh, not too bad. Keeping busy. I know you're busy.
Yeah, you know, I do radio. So I do morning radio in Barrie, Midland, and Orillia for Pure Country 106. So morning radio is kind of a double-edged sword because it's like the best gig ever, but it, you know, I get up at 3:30. So yeah. It's all right. It's cool. It's just having fun, and it's a great way to be plugged into the music industry when there's yeah, but you know, it's not no shows going on. So
No, you've already done your work on what Barrie Pure Country 106. How's that?
Pure Country 106. Yeah.
So that used to be a kick station, right? And then I guess our iHeart Radio gobbled them up.
Yep. Bell is the parent company now, and you have 13 Pure Country stations across the country. So and it's pretty cool. You know, you really get to, you know, from being an artist on one side of radio and now being on the other side, you know, I'm not the programmer, but you get to see all those programming decisions and, you know, just the interaction with artists and labels in a different capacity. It's pretty cool.
Just doing my research for this interview, I stumbled on a YouTube video from you doing your morning show, and you had Megan on it as a guest. And, you know, you're doing
Megan Patrick, yeah.
Yeah, you're doing lots of fun stuff in between as you're waiting to go back on air. So,
well, with her, she hunts, right? So we were talking about how she likes to crossbow hunt and all this kind of stuff. So we got a bunch of Nerf guns. And then we did like ham skeet shooting. So I had to throw up like slices of ham or bologna, and she had to shoot it. So,
you know, I didn't watch that much.
she hasn't come back.
With COVID, has there been any restrictions on that with as far as guests coming in? And
yeah, we haven't had anyone in the studio. The only people in the studio have been my co-host Carrie and I. So the morning shows are the only ones in the building. Everyone else is broadcasting from home.
Okay.
So it's certainly, you know, a different dynamic. We always used to say about 9 o'clock, the grownups used to show up at the station. And now there's been no grownups for a few months, and we kind of like it.
Yeah. Listen, it keeps, like you said, it keeps your toe in the water. You can be home. And you know, you're still in connection with the industry, right? And
yeah, I like being home.
Yeah, I've read that in some and heard that in some of your previous interviews. You're, you know, focusing. You got your two kids, and your wife. I think we're the same age, and I think we've been married to not the same lady, but married to a lady for the whole time.
I've been married for 20 years, going into in our 21st year. And so it's been amazing. I mean, this summer is the first summer in years that I've been able to spend time with them, like real quality time. I mean, we bought a boat, so we've been out on that. We've been busy, nice. You know, just being a family, and really enjoy it.
Well, me and my son just started fishing for the first time, so that's been cool. We haven't caught anything, but we're trying.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah, he's enjoying it. So you're going to be a co-host again for CMA Ontario, which is in October. You'll be co-hosting with Jennifer Campbell. My last interview actually was with Brian Allen. So we talked a bit about that because he's been a director of that association for 10 plus years or so. So he was alluding to some cool ideas that you're going to try to do. Is there anything you can kind of share on that?
Well, I guess they've yet to tell me, really. I've talked to Viril there as well. And she's got a few ideas in the works. I don't know if anything's solidified. Maybe Brian and her have nailed some things down. But I pretty much do whatever they say. Here's the sheet of paper, read it, and don't go off the script, which never works because I always go off the script. But it's a great bunch of folks. And, you know, when I was growing up in the industry, we didn't have a real focused Ontario Country Music Association, right? So. Right. And it always seemed that all the, you know, country folks were from the West, right? And they were the ones that got celebrated the most. And I was like, you know, like I grew up a bit in Alberta when I was a little guy, but
right.
I'm from Ontario and I knew we always had this great country music here. Great country music history. The Ottawa Valley alone was amazing, you know, from Terry Carice to all the artists, Johnny Burke, who was from the East, but he was Ontario based, and all of my favorite artists were from here. Yeah. And it's just nice to see that, you know, we have this really great organization now. So, and so many great artists are from Ontario.
How many years have you hosted it?
Five, maybe. Oh. I'm not really sure. Charlie Major did it the year before me. And then I started hosting. I'm not sure how that all worked, but, and I, you know, Jennifer will be co-hosting this year. And so, yeah, I'm just happy to be back. It's a lot of fun. It's
that's great.
It's a different, I guess, a different dynamic of what I do.
Yeah. You know? Well, I know last year, you know, a previous guest of mine, Paul Chapman, who's in Western Swing Authority, they were the house band. And, you know, according to the CMA Ontario website, they were the house band again. So that's pretty cool. You can't really get a better house band.
No, they're the best. And, you know, they're really the best on and off stage. I mean, most of those folks in that band have worked with me over the years, from Jim Boudreau to, well, you name it, like all of them. And they're just great.
Most of us are in lockdown. But you decided to do something about it kind of early on into the lockdown. You came up with this song idea to raise money for Red Cross and, you know, the COVID charities. We are one. So you put this song together and you just had like a crap load of, you know, amazing talent sing on it, and a lot from Ontario. So how has that been going? And, you know, how did you get the idea, and how's that been going, and how's the raise been going? Because now it's been out since April.
Yeah, the money raised is a bit of an odd one, because it's coming in from music royalties,
right,
and web play royalties, so YouTube and all that kind of thing. So it's hard to say in some ways, because we haven't really seen the money yet, but we're donating it all to like say Red Cross, also Global Citizen, and Unison Funds. So as we start to see, I guess that'll be coming in this fall, we'll be able to hand those checks over. And it's pretty interesting, because that was something that happened. A friend of mine, Jim Payetta from Barrie, him and I just had this idea for this song, and it just exploded. I mean, it happened, I think we were 2 weeks into the pandemic hitting our shores here. And I guess probably 9 to 12 days, we had the bed tracks and the general idea of the, like, wrote it, had the bed tracks and the guests pretty much lined up. And so, I don't know, within 3-4 weeks, it was done and out. It was super quick, but I mean, that's the community that we play in. I mean, all the musicians were like, yeah, let's do this. Russell Broom, I'll never forget. I called him from my front porch and I was like, okay, first of all, I'm glad you answered. You know, not sure you will be, but I got this project for you. It doesn't pay anything, but it's going to be a lot of work. And so he was the producer, and he was getting tracks in from everywhere. And then and Sean Smith, who did the video out in Calgary, same thing. He was just like, he's gung-ho. He's like, let's do this thing. And he got all these people filming themselves in their cameras, you know, and he put it all together. Yeah. It was amazing.
Yeah, you guys really took the a cappella app to the next level. That's for sure.
There you go, right? But you know, I had very little to do with it, really. I mean, I wrote the tune, great. And we got the ideas. So
yeah, it's great. I mean, I'll drop some names. Guys that stood out to me when I watched it a few times. Gordy Johnson, who I think would be a cool guest on this program. Guy's cool. Ed Robertson, Derek Rutan, he's an Ontario guy. Aaron Brichette, Carolyn Don Johnson, Tim Hicks, and then my previous guest, who actually gave me your email, so thanks to David Kalmuski. There's a scene where David's on there with Greg Morrow. Like, you really couldn't find a better drummer.
Yeah.
I mean, he's kind of played with everybody.
It was great. And then from around the world, we had Jessica Falk from Sweden. We had Haley Jensen from Australia. And it just, you know, it was great. And one of my favorite guitar players, Pablo, I mean, he was, he grabbed the nylon string, and he's a virtuoso.
Like, yeah, for sure.
Amazing. Yeah. He hooked us up with Zoe and Grease. She played the accordion. I called him. I said, you know, I want you to play guitar on this and give it kind of a world feel. And I said, who around the world do you think would be cool to add to this? He goes, oh, Zoe from Greece. And I said, what's she play? And he said, well, accordion. And I was like, that's different, because we could have like a kind of a droning thing in it. Man, it made the song. It was like some sort of a, it's just this, well, it's right at the beginning. It's just, it's such a great flavor, and she's such a tasteful player. So it was neat to have people from all over the world do their thing, you know.
You mentioned that artist from Sweden. Was that real? Like the piano on the lake, or was that?
Yeah.
That was
apparently
real.
Apparently when you do anything in Sweden, you do it like way over the top, and it's awesome. So Jessica Falk, she's an artist, and she's a session musician and all that. And she does lots of social media videos and things. So, I don't know how they did it, but they pulled a grand piano out onto a lake, a frozen lake, and filmed her like in high def film. Like, it's just, I don't know how they did it.
Yeah. I thought maybe there was some trickery to that, but,
well, Jessica came to us through Scott Baggett, our longtime producer.
Yeah, for sure.
And, Scott was on it. He kicks off the whole thing with his B3. And, he's done records with her. I think he had her over in Nashville a few times, and then he's been over there to work with her on different sessions. And he said, oh, you got to get Jessica on this. So he put that all together. I haven't officially spoken with her other than the emails. So I don't know how they did it, but I know they did it for real.
Well, maybe they cut out the end part that includes going under.
No. Yeah, I've got a pond here. I'm looking at the pond here. Maybe when it freezes over, I might shoot a video on it, but probably I'd get a backhoe and I'd put it through the ice or something like that.
So I read somewhere that your daughter was the one that suggested getting the Harlem Gospel Choir on it.
Well, she hooked it up, actually. Yeah. So I was saying, like, I want a choir on this. And then I was watching the news. They were talking about the Harlem Gospel Choir and all that they'd done. And they'd had to cancel a string of shows in New York because it was the epicenter at the time. And I said, well, there's no way we're going to get a choir on this. And certainly not them, because they're right in the middle of all this.
Yeah.
And so she went upstairs and she came down. She said, well, I found an email on their website. Why don't you try it? So I was like, okay.
That's great.
So I did. And like 5 minutes later, I got a call from Anna Bailey, who's their manager. And it just was great. I mean,
oh, that's great. Like,
holy smokes, man. They're just the best.
It's been floating around on Facebook. You probably saw it. Everybody's showing around this interview that the CEO of Spotify did, you know, where he's telling artists, you just need to record more if you want to make more. But we got to reach out. We got to get the per stream amount from, we got to drop a zero. You know, that'll kind of help you raise some money, right?
You know, it's zero, zero. Like, there is so much music out there from when I started recording. Like,
yeah,
I said, well, you know, it's just a totally different landscape. I mean, sure. all the guests you've had on your show too. I mean, they've seen the whole cycle too. And Jason Barrie being a producer of every kind of genre. And it's an amazing time. It's also a confusing time, right? Because, you know, a million plays on Spotify, you know, equals very little.
Yeah.
And so I got, you know, my son plays piano. He was doing a piano lesson here. And and I was thinking, what if he started a band? What would that be like? And they went on tour and, you know, it'd be really hard. And I feel bad for them at first. And then I think, but there's always, you know, there's Harry Styles comes out and there's like, you know, all these different artists are just, you know, booming and it's going great.
Yeah.
So there are those that will find a way and change the equation. So I'm interested to see what the next generation does with that.
Yeah. I mean, listen, I don't want to get into a long conversation about streaming, but it is what it is and we can't go back. So you kind of have to figure out how to make it work going forward. Right. Cause
that's what I mean. Like it's an amazing time. Yeah. Like it's interesting. It's a time of transition, but there's always that younger generation that just changes.
They figure it out. They figure it out.
Yeah. You know? This is how it works.
Yeah. Just like the kids did in the 60s, right? You know?
Yeah. With these newfangled vinyl records.
Yeah. They figured it out, you know? So we move forward. Talking about numbers, the song Mud, which was off your Wheels, talking about the Road Hammers here, off the Wheels, that song just went platinum. I saw that.
Yeah. That was a great surprise. We had a conference call with our record label. We were talking about different things and like, oh, this would be a good time to let you know that platinum record is coming your way from Mud.
That's like, great. Wow. Yeah.
That was a nice surprise. But that song, we love playing live because, you know, everybody just, you know, sings along and it's, you know, who doesn't love jumping in a mud puddle or, you know, at any age, it makes you feel like you're five again. But it's been a great song for us.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. You did that one with Jeffrey Steele.
Yeah. So, Scott Baggett, who I mentioned, you know, we got together with Jeff, we'd written with him before I guess we started at about 10 o'clock at night, and by about 2 in the morning, we had a demo that was pretty much the record done. It just, it was one of, you know, the odd time you hear those songs that just write themselves, and that was one of them. Like everything you hear on that, other than the drums, you mentioned Greg Morrow, we had him put the drums on after the fact. Or was it Chad Cromwell? One or the other.
One of those slouches.
Yeah, one of those slouches. It was Chad, who's building a house in California right now. If you follow him on Instagram, you know the struggles he's been going through out there. But anyway, Chad played drums on it after, and then Chris played bass, and Clay and Chris both, you know, put their vocals on it. We added some electric guitars. But other than that, that whole thing was done in just a few hours.
That's cool.
it's amazing. And it's one of my favorite tracks because it's just fun, you know.
So now, you know, with COVID, everything is, you know, obviously a lot of things got rescheduled or canceled. But you were part of a big fundraiser for the TELUS Ride for Dad, which was obviously going to be a live show, but which was rescheduled. A fight against to raise money to, you know, for prostate cancer. Obviously that has a lot of special meaning to you, but you know, you put a lot of work into that cause, and but you know, you did a Facebook live show and you just had a slew of guests.
Well, I've been national spokesman for Ride for Dad for a few years now. And my dad was a prostate cancer survivor, so yeah, that's something that's, you know, near and dear to my heart as far as the cause goes. And you know, the coolest part about that ride is that I started with the Heronia ride up here in Orillia. And so the coolest part, when I just started with them, I was just kind of riding in it and just kind of hanging out, you know. And then I saw what they did and I saw the real effects they were having. So all the money that's raised in your chapter, all that money stays in your area for research. And so they'd bring the doctors up from Toronto who were working actively on research, who get the money and they'd accept the check. So these researchers, these surgeons, all these people would come up and they'd talk about all the advancements they'd make and how they've got things down to such few treatments and all. It's just amazing. So I was like, this is for real. It's not money that goes somewhere. I don't know where it goes.
Yeah. I guess you really like the directness of it.
Oh, amazing. Like, so
you see it.
Yeah. Really great organization, top to bottom. So, but yeah, man, I got to tell you, like this virtual event we did, George Canyon on, Clayton, Bellamy from, you know, Hammers, he's got his solo record. And so it did, gosh, who all did we have on that? We had, we've done a few of those. We had a whole pile. We've been doing a bunch of these and you get everybody together and then I kind of just, it just blurs into one. Brett Kissel. And it's really cool. Like, you know, when you ask these artists and they just jump on board, but it's like, hey man, would you, it's like, I haven't even asked you yet. They're just musicians, back to the, you know, we are one world. Like musicians just have a, the music community, not just country, but the music community has a real heart to lend their time and talent. And I don't know if it's because, you know, it doesn't really cost you anything to sing something, but that's their trade. So if they're a welder, like I wouldn't go to somebody and say, hey, will you weld this big thing for free? Right. But the training they've had as a musician is equal, you know?
Yeah. We're a different breed, right? You know, it works for us at times and it does ourselves in at times. Right.
Yeah. Well, it's been great through watching this, not just for my projects, but all the projects in the music industry. It's just, there's been a lot of great things come out of this.
Listen, for myself, I mean, I got to, you know, just starting a YouTube channel. It's not like you're going to get like huge promotion from this, but you know, there's been just monster talent in the Ontario area. You know, everybody just kind of said yes when I sent out an email, you know.
Well, it's cool. It's great to be asked because, you know, we like to
talk thank you.
Music. Well, it's nice to talk about music. I mean, that's what we love to do, right? And so and then you bring it, you have a different take on it and a different angle and you have different questions to ask. And it's just interesting. You know, it's good to chat and kind of explore different things.
I like to touch on what's most current at first. So we'll just touch on something the Roadhammers have been doing, which I didn't see it 5 years ago, but on your, on the Roadhammers Instagram channel, which, you know, it's worth checking out. You re-released a series of these. I've Been Everywhere that you guys did on CMT about 5 years ago. So it's really cool. It's that song, I've Been Everywhere, but it's because you know, you can't go anywhere. So you've been everywhere, but they're hilarious. Like, I watched a few.
That was fun. Yeah. And I really like shooting those. It's called Roadhammers Go Everywhere. It's on Instagram. It's on YouTube as well. But it's like, what happened was we shot a video or a couple of videos in 1 week out in Edmonton. And then we had the camera and an extra day of budget. So we just went around town and acted like a bunch of jackasses for a while. And then we filmed some behind the scenes of the Bands on the Run tour with Black Jack Billy and Doc Walker. And it was just fun. And you know what? I love watching those because it was a really cool time in our band when it was just fun. Everybody was just having a good time and we weren't thinking about anything. And yeah, it's pretty obvious we weren't using our heads.
I was flipping around and it's just my luck. I happened to stumble on the male stripper one, and I was like, I gotta find another one.
Raphael,
yeah.
Sexy pants.
Yeah, you kind of look like you're enjoying yourself. No,
awkward. I appreciate talent. It was odd. So what happened was we were playing at the Commodore Ballroom. It was the last show of the tour. And it was a sold out show. And we had been punking in Black Jack Billy and Doc Walker mercilessly this whole tour. And I forget the pranks we pulled on them, but it was just nonstop. So the last show of the tour, they hired a male stripper named Rafael. And he's, where is he from, Argentina or something? And halfway through mud, he comes out with a bucket of mud in his Speedo and decides to smear it all over his body. Like, oh, God. It's pretty hard. It's pretty hard to keep singing. You're like, okay, all right, well. When I requested dancers, this isn't what I thought.
So it was a total surprise to you.
Oh yeah, that was a total surprise. That was pretty good. That was Chris and Jeff from Doc Walker and Black Jack Billy.
So. Very cool. So let's go back to the start for a bit. It's always people always want to hear how people got started. So you know, your love from country music, as from what I read about you, came from your dad. And he had an old Stella guitar with one of those amazing bridges. And you got started playing guitar on that.
Yeah, I still have it.
That's cool.
It's downstairs. Yeah, it had three strings on it. So it had the G, B, and E. And these three were missing. And I asked him to buy me a full set of six. But, a bunch of things that you ask for and you just never use them. It's a waste of money. So he said, if you can learn a song on the three, I'll give you a full set of six. So I think it took me about a day, and I learned chords on the three strings. I learned, darling, I'm feeling pretty lonesome. And so he got the full set of six, and that was it. But my dad always played country music on the radio. My one sister loved Donny Osmond. The other one loved Barry Manilow. So I was sticking with my dad.
That's great. So, you were born here. Well, not here, but there. Barrie and Minising, right, where you are now. And you did a little stopover in Alberta, in Camrose, Alberta, for a bit because your dad was changing jobs. And you got some exposure to, you had your country music exposure, and then you had your exposure to country hats and cowboy boots. So so coming back to Ontario, you were a country boy.
Yeah, I got back here. I couldn't figure out why the kids in school weren't wearing hats and boots. Like, it was a little weird. But it's a farming community here. And so it was, not far off from what I was used to.
Okay.
I always say, I'm from Alberta, or from Ontario, but I was raised a bit in Alberta. And so I really feel that way too, because those are my first memories.
Yeah.
But it's great. And you know what? Every time we go out and play the Camrose Festival, Big Valley, I always like to go and drive by that old area where I grew up, because there's something about the pasture land and the meadows there and just the wild grasses and stuff. There is a certain distinct feel to that region. And there's not much that really takes me back, but that's, just driving through there, stopping on the side of the road and just kind of smelling everything. It does.
Yeah. Nothing like good manure.
Yeah. That's pretty much it.
Well, I mean, we're the same age. So I'm kind of thinking back, when I was starting guitar, roughly around the same time, like 12. And I grew up in Hamilton. But at that time, I mean, the kids that you kind of came in contact with that were also trying to play guitar, I mean, it was Van Halen, it was Ozzy Osbourne, Def Leppard. I mean, or you were a blues guy and it was Stevie Ray Vaughan. But was it hard, like in Barrie at that time, trying to find other kids that wanted to play country music?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. When I was in school, it was the same thing. It was all, on the Canadian side, Summer of 69 had just come out, and Gump, Van Halen. And then there was all the metalheads,
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
like the Van Halen was the great rectifier. Everybody could get into them, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But you were into Iron Maiden, or you're into, and then metal had its own subgroups too, right? If you were into Maiden, Priest, you couldn't really be into Twisted Sister. You know what I mean? That was like, you know, metal light. Yeah. So it was, you know, I didn't know where to fit in because I played guitar and I hooked up with a couple of guys. We had a metal band, but we never ever played or practiced. But I had a PA system from playing country, like a small little PA, a couple sticks, you know, so I was in the band. But I bought a BC Rich. I bought a, like, I forget what it was called, but it had like half a bat wing on it or whatever. And, it was the dumbest guitar ever. It sounded horrible. But when I was young, like, I took a bunch of cassettes to school. Kids can Google what cassettes are. And I took cassettes to school of Ricky Skaggs live in London. So I was learning like all that, like all the tapping crap, you know? And trying to keep up with all these metal guys because I wanted to be in the club.
Yeah.
And so I learned a bit of it, but I was never good at it. But then I brought in live in London, Ricky Skaggs, and I played them Country Boy.
Yeah.
And they were just like, I remember when I stopped the cassette and one of the guys was like, so is he picking each note like individually?
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah. So all of a sudden they were like, Ricky Skaggs, is it? Yeah. And it was pretty cool because, you know, that was – there wasn't anybody else in the country. And now there's such a great group of young people in the country.
Oh, yeah. 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 No, you're right. I mean, I remember as a kid just having arguments with people because, oh, Randy Rhoads is the best, you know, and
Randy Travis is best. Yeah. Randy Travis versus Randy Rhoads.
So
Randy Rhoads, but on the same side of the coin, like I thought Ricky Skaggs was the best. But Randy Rhoads,
yeah, I mean, he was great.
So young, and that the Crazy Train solo is one of the best. Like that's one of the best guitar tracks.
That's true. It's very melodic.
So inspired, and even like it was so fluid. It was like it wasn't mechanical at all. Like I mean, he was the best, and it's just like everybody has those performances. When I was young, like you know, between the Metalheads and the Duran Durans and all that, like the Great Rectifier as well was that.
You know, so I got me to play with the thumb.
Right. Knopfler was it for me, right? Because he had the, you know, and I went to see him at Massey Hall. This is an interesting thing because he hooked up with all the Nashville guys to do his later like sailing in Philadelphia and all that stuff. And he had Chad Cromwell. He had from Steve Earle's Records there, Richard
Peterson.
Him. That guy. Anyway, just great players. He had Glenn Wharf on bass, and he had so on and so forth, and Russ Paul on steel. So they played on a session of mine in Nashville, and then I went to Massey Hall and to watch Knopfler's show, and I got to backstage and hang with them because I kind of knew the musicians, so they got me got me hooked up. And so I go backstage and Knopfler and his people are already like, you know, like, oh, you know, fan wants to meet him. So I kind of walk past Knopfler and I'm like, hey, man, that sounded great. And he's like, who's this guy? I got to meet him and he was so really gracious. He was as cool as you'd think he was. You know, he was just this little old, Englishman with a pipe and a guitar, you know.
So, yeah.
So cool.
Do you ever watch, he's big on YouTube, Greg Koch.
Yeah.
Hilarious guy and an incredible picker. But that was his influence for country was listening to Knopfler and just getting the sound of the clicking, you know, between using the thumb and the fingers. And that's what got him going. Yeah.
Yeah. Knopfler always has like, you know, you got your Chet Atkins. It's like. Real smooth. Right. And that, you know. And Knopfler's always got that.
Yeah.
It's just more of a thud, you know?
Yeah.
And
exactly.
Of course, just use the thumb. It's really great. But he's, the other thing he's really great out of those inversions that are so different. Like, he, like that.
Yeah.
You don't realize how much that swings till you hear him play it on a dobro.
That's true. Sounds cool, man.
It's so groovy. And the thing, secret to that song is never play it too fast. You hear a couple bands in the bar and they're always, and it's just like, oh God, we got to go.
That's great. But anyway, so you know, what kind of launched your career? From what I could tell, there was a contest you entered in Barrie, and you won, and which led you to do a recording. So that kind of started the whole process for you.
Yeah, I won a contest at a place called Tom Dooley's downtown Barrie. I was 16. I got a bit of studio time, and that led to recording in Nashville with Ray Griff, who's Canadian at the time.
Right.
You know, massive songwriter, all that kind of stuff. I was 16. I did a record. Didn't do anything with it. It was what they'd call a custom record to a degree. And then I just, you know, didn't do a whole lot around here until I was about 20. And then got into, met Scott Baggett through my current manager, Ron. And we just, you know, he was a rock and roller, and I was as Randy Travis as you could possibly think.
This used to be our town. This used to be our town.
And so we're pretty polar opposites, but the thing that bonded us was he went to Nashville to, you know, take on the rock and roll and blues industry, right? Because there was a lot big scene for that there too.
Yeah, yeah.
But he ended up, you know, in a collared Western shirt with the stitched roses in it. And he was playing for all different Opry acts of the day. He played bass, you know, and they liked him because they were kind of coming out of this age of coolness for them. They're getting a little older and they needed these young guys in the band to be, you know, cool. And so he was kind of this young rock and roller and kind of lent some hip credibility to what they did. So that was what our bridge, the gap for what we had between us, you know, him being the rock guy, being the country guy. So
yeah,
we could talk that language all day, and it was great. So I really enjoyed that.
That's been a long relationship because you did all the solo stuff and then the Hammer stuff too, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the Hammer stuff is really where Scott shines because it's like Girl in the Billboard, you know, Del Reeves, you know.
Yeah, that's a cool song.
It's interesting because that was a song I loved when I was a kid. He played with Del Reeves. So, you know, he's used to the old Opry, you know, who is the girl wearing nothing but a smile and towel in the picture, you know, that kind of thing. But he also, you know, he knows all the guys from NRBQ and Big Al. And yeah, then, you know, you put Scott's take on it. It's got that, you know, it's got that swing. And that's what we did. Put Al on it and got Chad to play on it. And so one of the things I loved about having, you know, Glenn Wharf and Chad Cromwell on the early records was when I was in Nashville, I didn't really know anybody. So on Sundays, I'd go to the Bluebird, and it was long before it was a big deal, and nobody'd be in there, maybe five people, and it'd be the Blue Bloods playing. It was Mike Henderson on guitar and Glenn and Chad. And Glenn and Chad just have this thing from having played live on stage for so many years, they're just reading each other's mail all the time. And they both came from that, you know, that swampy Memphis thing. And they could make a straight hit record for Kenny Chesney. And then they could lay it down with the heaviest blues players ever. And Mike Henderson, you know, they'd Little Red Rooster and all those kind of classic, like it just was off the hook great. And, you know, he'd have those, oh gosh, I forget what he used to play through. He'd have all different types of weird, awesome amps. And Glenn always played through the Ampeg, where you take the head and you flip it up and all the guts are sticking up, whatever is.
The bass amp, yeah.
Yeah, and it was just like you could just smell those tubes just cooking from the stage. You know what I mean? Those kind of nights.
Yeah,
it was just the best. And
that's awesome.
Yeah, that was great. So then having those guys, they laid down the rhythm on stuff like Girl on the Billboard and I'm a Road Hammer, and it just clicked. It was just magic because
That was a great album. I'm a big fan because that was a cool CD. I remember listening to that a lot. I mean, Eastbound, your version Eastbound Down was great. I mean, I've played that song so many times, but I revert back to the Reed version because some of your solo stuff there was a little tricky.
A little weird. Yeah. You know what? It was the thing about it is when I was a kid, Jerry Reed was like like there was country musicians, like in your stars, and then there was Jerry Reed, right? Like
Yeah.
And he was, because he was everything, right? He was the coolest dude ever, Snowman.
Yeah.
And so I came to him through movies first and then got to know him on the radio. My dad would point it out, oh, that's Smokey and the Bandit, that's him.
Yeah.
And so I'd learn more about, you know, Jerry Hubbard. And then I learned more about him probably in the last 5-6 years from neat old footage on YouTube, right?
Yeah,
like there's
sure.
there's footage of him playing a song called Lightning Rod on Nashville Now with Ralph Emery. And I got to do Nashville Now with Ralph Emery years ago, of course, before they pulled the show off the air.
Yeah.
But anyway, and Jerry's on there and the band for the artist is like way over here, right?
Yeah.
And he's on a gut string guitar in front of a microphone and he's playing this wicked fast song, Lightning Rod. Like it's like play to the bumblebee, you know. Yeah. And it's locked in so tight with that band. And he's just prompting them and playing with them. He was like quintessential. And he's just not even trying. And it was a performer like beyond everybody else. It's one thing when musicians play the claw or something like that, or Eastbound and Down, you're like, wow, you nailed that. Now write it. Like who could think of the claw? Like
all the harmonies he did. Yeah. There's lots of stuff on him that, you know, between him and Chet would have to learn it because when it came to record it, he couldn't play it again. Like he would just come up with this stuff. But then if you asked him to play it again, he couldn't do it, you know? So there's some really cool stuff between him and Chet. But you know what? It's kind of cool because you kind of remind me of him in a sense, you know?
Oh,
like,
dear. I haven't taken nearly enough cocaine and whiskey to deserve that. Thank you very much.
But, you know, if you kind of look at it, kind of, you know, you're a big entertainer, you know, entertaining. And, well, you know, we can get into that later, but because I wanted to. But you really take the entertainment part in your show really up a notch. You're kind of like, you know, the Canadian Garth Brooks kind of thing. Like you put a lot into it. And I could see, you know, maybe you pulled some of that entertainment factor from him. I could see that. You're telling jokes all the time. And
What I learned from Jerry Reed and watching him was that, you know, being yourself is okay. Like, Jerry Reed didn't try to be anybody, right? He couldn't be. Like, and I found that this is funny because in my early career life, I would try to be like Dwight Yoakam or something like that, where you want to be really cool on stage and everything. You know, you go on stage and you're this guy, you know? And I remember I did a run of theater dates and my wife used to travel with me and I was just a bear. It was like, you know, your monitors would suck that night and I'd just be, you know, so mad and I'd be just pulling these little princess hissy fits, right? Like, you know, and it was just so stupid. And then one night something went wrong on stage. Like every time something went wrong on stage, I'd internalize it, right? Because it was something against me performing or, you know, something to hold me back, right?
Yeah.
And I was the jackass holding me back. What happened was something bad happened on stage one night and I was, because I'd always be the serious guy on stage and then try, and I was always kind of goofy and funny off stage.
Okay.
And then something happened one night, like the microphone stand broke or whatever. And I made a joke of it and it was got this huge laugh from the audience. And I just did played along and made it part of the show. And I was like, oh, this is so all of a sudden this big curtain just went boom and fell down. It was like, mistakes are awesome. Like, you know, when a show goes too good, sometimes you're a little pissed off because there's nothing to play with. But that was probably, and I think it was up in like Vanderhoof, BC or something, theater up there and just made fun of it. And it was just great. And that kind of allowed me to just be myself. But Jerry Reed was like that too. Like, you'd see all these,
the hee-haw stuff and, you know,
like whatever, man, just let her go. And the music industry is obviously more like now because everything is, you know, what we're doing right now, Zoom, like you could have my kids or my dog could walk by right now. You know, it's just more real life and it's more realistic. And it's nicer.
I'm going to jump around here just because we were talking about that. But, you know, when the Hammers kind of went on hiatus, for 3 years, you were doing like kind of like a one man show in theaters and I caught a little bit of that. And I mean, it was really entertaining. I mean, you're doing the music, but you're also doing like stand up and you're doing it really well. Like you're actually interacting with the crowd and feeding off each other and handling hecklers. And I mean, I was like, holy shit, I didn't realize he could do all that.
So you saw one of those shows?
Yeah. No, it was pretty. Yeah, I'll say that's damn impressive.
Wow, that's great. Because I
my heart is beating so, and then anyone can tell think you know me well, but you don't know me.
I kind of stopped after that. We jumped back into the Hammers, and you know, I love doing the Hammer stuff, but you know, there's only so many hours in the day.
Yeah.
But I really wish I had done more of that. And maybe
I could see you doing more of that. I could definitely see you doing more of that.
I love it. Like, and you know what is interesting with what's going on with COVID right now? Those were smaller theaters, right? That was like anything 300 to 400 seats, or maybe even, you know, less we'd do.
Yeah, there's
and
tons of
a screen, and we'd have other artists join me, you know, virtually. But I could see that type of entertaining, not just from myself, but like you're seeing all these artists doing these backyard concerts, like Corey Kelly from Tour Bus, he's doing these.
Yeah, you were ahead of your time.
It's really great. And so these artists are kind of allowed to interact in a different way than on a big, you know, big stage. You know what I mean? Because they'll tell more stories and just talk. And
like a female singer show up on the screen and you were doing a duet. Like
that was Stacy from Western Swing.
Yeah, very pre-COVID.
Very pre-COVID.
You're forward thinking.
I was socially distancing through pre-recorded audio and video.
Well, you're kind of big time, but you know, guys like me, we've been playing at bars at 20% capacity for a long time.
Oh, dude, yeah, I've played all those, like you name it, and I've played it. And
lots of social distancing at bars, you know, when it's just, before it's COVID.
It's the bar owner and like the guy who, you know,
couple waitresses,
the cook, and they're forced to come out and sit with you and drink cold draft or warm drafts while you're playing bad Randy Travis covers.
So before you getting hooked up with Scott Baggett, I thought I'd throw this one in there because it's kind of cool. Previous guest of mine was Wendell Ferguson, but you ended up doing some recording at when he had the studio, Orchard Studio out in Brampton. Orchard Studio,
that's right. That's right.
You remember
him? Him and Dave, I think, had the studio out there. Yeah, and it was my first, after the Ray Griff thing, it was the first time recording with, you know, pro musicians in Canada.
Yeah.
And it was great because Wendell did and then I asked him to be the band leader for a showcase I was doing for record labels, which actually led to an MCA thing that we did.
Okay.
Through Ed Harris at West. But anyway, he brought in his band. It was called Code of the West, and they were the backup band. And I made them all wear the same clothes and like a, you know, white shirt, black pants and all this stuff. It was a different time in country for sure. But, and Wendell's always been a really great mentor to me in a lot of ways that he doesn't even know, you know, he's been band leader and music director for the CMA. He's really great. And he's super knowledgeable. And he's, he is the guy you want when the ship is sinking. Cause he's just super calm. Like he's seen it all. Nothing rattles him, you know, and that's
a good point.
He's done everything from the big CBC stuff down to, you know, the bar with two people in it, like we talked about. And
do you know a local guy in Toronto, Ed Smith, the singer?
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
I don't know, but yeah.
So I don't know if you've seen this. So Ed Smith does, you know, just, you know, in the last month or so, I think he does them on the weekends out on his lawn. You know, he does a lawn show. You know who's in his band? It's incredible. So you got Wendell. This is last week. Wendell on guitar, John Diamond on bass, Gary Craig on drums, Doug Johnson on steel. I can't remember. And a fiddle player. I can't remember her name. Sorry about that. But unbelievable, eh? Those names I just dropped. They play on the front lawn of his house.
For real. Just jamming on the mic.
Yeah. You know,
and a lot of people just sitting there or passing by won't understand the pedigree of those players.
It's unbelievable. Like, I know a lot of those guys were on your Everything album, John Diamond amazing. And Gary Craig. Yeah.
Gary Craig is like, Gary Craig and John Diamond are like the.
Yeah, the ultimate rhythm.
They're like the Glenn Wharf, Chad Cromwell, you know, equivalent. Like, it's
I was lucky enough, I got to interview Colin Linden. So, you know.
He produced the Everything album.
Oh, he did. I didn't know that.
Or no, Sins Lies and Angels, sorry. Sins Lies and Angels.
Oh, okay, because I saw David Kalmuski was involved in some production and mixing on Everything, right?
On Everything, the Sins Lies and Angels album was Colin, and we did it at the Bath House, the Hips place in Bath, Kingston, and it was so cool because I didn't know anything about Colin at the time. Like, I kind of got hooked up through my manager, and I kind of didn't really listen to a lot of that stuff, but I kind of got it, you know, and I knew that he did Bruce Coburn stuff. And I was like, well, let's give it a shot, right? But he's a rock guy, so I wonder if he's going to get this country thing. Wow, it was great. And he's so, and he's another guy like Wendell. He's just, he's seen it all. Nothing freaks him out.
It's he's like, had an unbelievable career.
Blah, blah, blah. He's like, we'll fix it when we do this. Just settle down, young boy. And so I learned a lot from Colin. And he was the first guy to turn me on to the Rezzo Electric.
Sure.
I mean, he's got every cool guitar. But he's like the master of it. When he was like 14 or 15 years old, him and a friend got in. Do you know his history about this?
Well, I interviewed him. So I got the whole story. With Wolf there in Toronto.
Like, for real, right? He's like, he says, here's this 15 or whatever year old Jewish boy going down to Mississippi to find, you know, Howlin' Wolf to it. Like, and these guys were blown away by it. And he's just.
Yeah, he's a cool guy. And then all the association with the band, which is, you know, the band's probably the, it's the ultimate band.
Minor footnote in musical history.
Yeah. I often bounce ideas off a friend of mine who was an early guest on this program, Fred Lewis. And when I mentioned I was going to have you on, he told me about a project you worked on years ago, I think back in 99, with a guest of mine, Doug DeVoe, who runs Sideman Studios out in Oshawa. And he had put together this album to feature steel players called Northern Steel. And you sang and played guitar on the Hagar tune, Honky Tonk Nighttime Man. You remember much about that?
You know, I do. It was a while ago. But I, you know, as we're talking, it's all coming back. Now, Doug's really, he's one of those unique guys that he's a real quiet, behind the scenes kind of guy. You know, he's got the studio and he's a great engineer. He's a real sound, you know, he's a tone guy, right?
Yeah.
So, it's always nice when you're doing even a live show and he shows up and he's the production guy or whatever it is. Whenever he's around, it always sounds better. So to do a steel album, take somebody who understands tone, right? And I think like some of the players, like Bob Tyfer was one of the steel players, I think, on that as well. One of my favorite dudes, you know, he's just a great guy. And so it was one of my favorite songs, one of my favorite Haggard songs.
Yeah, it's
and
cool.
I love it. I just love it because it's... Well, it's been covered by rock bands too, you know,
like Skinner.
I think everybody knows it, right? Whether you're in a rock band or a cover band, it just speaks to the power of Merle Haggard and his writing and his records. So, and I had, I bought a box set and that was one of my favorite CDs. I think it was the Epic Years that song is from. But anyway, that was constant rotation. And I like to play it in my live show as well, as much as I can.
Cool. Well, here, I'll just throw out the names that were on it that you played with. On Steel, on that track, was Dale Rivard and Andy Schick. And then Fiddle was Don Reed, who's been on a ton of stuff. And you sang, you kind of traded off singing with Rick Jones. And drums was Sean O'Grady, who's been pretty well played with, I think, all my guests. And Darren LaChance was on guitar. He's a great guitar player. And Andrew Fleck on Affleck on bass. Oh, we got family members in this. Hello.
It was great. Grace and the dogs, Buddy and Luna. Hey. Andy Schick, there he played my band for a number of years. He's just one of my he was in my wedding as well.
Oh wow!
He was at my wedding party. So Andy's a good friend, and always great to have him on the track. I forgot he played on that one. And Dale Rivard played in my band years ago as well. So it's kind of like all roads, you know. All roads lead to Jason.
Back to Scott Baggett. You did. You recorded a handful of tunes, which got you lined up with MCA, and then that led to the first album, Playing for Keeps, which had the song "Born Again Dixieland," "Born Again in Dixieland," and that changed everything.
Yeah, we were up for Song of the Year at the CCMAs. I remember my co-writer Nisha and Denny Carr wrote it as well, but he was in Nashville. So Nisha and his wife, my wife and I, were at the CCMAs in Ottawa that year.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget, his wife goes, we saw a Mountie at the hotel before we got a limousine to go to the thing.
Yeah.
And she goes, I just love Mounties in uniform. And she gets a picture with them. And anyway, they opened the car door for the limo and there were Mounties lined up for about 200 feet on this red car. She just turned red. She said, so anyway, it was a funny night. It was great. It was just a magical night. So we're all sitting there in our chairs and they have a camera on you because if you're one of the possible winners, and we were up against Shania Twain. I forget what the song was at the time. And I'm like, well, you know, she's going to win it. And all I can say is when they announced our name, you couldn't hear what I said, but you could read my lips. And it started with holy, but it was amazing. And that changed everything. And you know, it's amazing because the song was never really meant to be. Like, we didn't have it all done when we were recording. I wrote the first verse and a bit of the chorus, and it was just something I wrote the day before. I had this phone conference with MCA, and in the evening, we were on the phone with them talking about what we were going to record the next day. And it was our last day to record, and I played them a song. They go, that's all right. Well, yeah, that's pretty good too. And I was down to nothing. I said, what about this one? And I kind of hummed through it, and they said, oh, we love that one. Is that done? And I was like, yeah.
Totally. Sure.
Yeah, and then we had to rush. We kind of just pieced in the, you know, placeholders for the second verse and maybe a bridge. And yeah, and then we recorded. We had to rush to record or finish the lyrics, and then we did, and it just changed everything. But that was recorded at the Battery in Nashville, which was the original Hillbilly Heaven that that Tom Paul Glazer, Willie Nelson, and Waylon Jennings and Jesse Coulter did the Outlaw record at.
Oh, cool.
So that story about Waylon Jennings where you know the song, Don't You Think This Outlaw Bit Done Got Out of Hand? You know,
I'll shake my head.
This outlaw bit done got out of hand. You know, singing through my nose done got me busted by the man. So he says,
you know what? Through Zoom, it actually sounds like it's got a phaser on it. So it works.
Oh, well, that's great. I was in the total wrong key. Don't you think this outlaw bit has done got out of hand? Anyway, he talks about having this envelope full of cocaine and the room fills up with law. And apparently the legend is he threw this envelope with cocaine in it and he threw it and went under this heat register in the room and they could never find it and they never busted him or whatever. But the vocals for Dixieland were recorded in that room. And that's the studio we did it all in. So all that.
Oh, very cool.
The Outlaw record was, that was it. It was Hillbilly Heaven owned by Tom Paul Glazer. And that's where the Hillbilly Outlaw movement started.
That's great. You know, after that, I guess came Honky Tonk Sonatas and Sin Lies and Angels, which we already kind of touched on. Actually, in my interview I did with Paul Chapman, I think I played a couple of, in the video, a couple of the solos that Paul did on it, because there's a couple of cool tunes on that stuff where Paul
just... All I know for Sin coming on is it starts with, that's all I know, and then the rest of Paul.
It's his voice doing the count-in, right?
Yeah, and every time I've tried to play that solo live, like, he rips it, and then I try to do my version, he just sits there on stage, and he laughs. He's got the best laugh ever.
Right? Yeah, like, yeah.
Oh, you know, he just can't keep up.
He's so fast and clean. It's just, when he does that fast stuff, it's...
And you know what's amazing with Chapman is when you bring up his solos on the grid, and you look at the kick and snare, like, he's
right up
there. Like, it's right there, man. Like, it's... I don't know if you ever have to fix anything. It's just and funny, we were doing Sin's Lies and Angels or a record. We had a song on there that was just required the electric to do, like, you know, just that kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was like, it was great. But then we did Sin coming on. It's like, he goes, oh, this is finally a tempo that's comfortable for me. He's like sweating. Yeah. I'm like, really?
That's funny.
He's like a hummer, right? It only makes sense at 1,000 miles per hour.
With all those albums out, and especially the Dixieland tune, you know, you won a lot of awards. You know, you were Country Male Singer of the Year kind of thing for and tons of nominations. But in 2006, you won Global Artist Award at the CMAs in Nashville.
It's given for artists that expand the boundaries of their domestic. And so I'd been touring in Australia and I'd done a couple of things overseas and other places too. And at the time I was quite active doing that. So I think it was kind of 04, 05, I was still touring as a solo artist. So then I got it in 06. So it was for that stuff I'd done in those years.
Oh, cool. I mean, that's a big deal. It's, you know, the CMAs.
It was amazing. I mean, obviously still got the award, but I look at it and I go, like, who's this guy? Like, I have no idea. I've got all these awards and it goes so fast. You're kind of like this summer, I'm not touring. And so you got life to enjoy and absorb at a reasonable pace. Up till then, you're just like, this is not normal. Like, where do these glass statues come from? You know, it's been amazing. What a ride. But then, and then the hammers took off and then Bob's your uncle. Cause I didn't know what to do after Sin's Lies and Angels.
Well, let's talk about that. Cause you know, I kinda, you know, seen, you know, doing research and just seeing your career as it's going, you know, cause enjoy country music and always kind of listen to you as your albums came out. but you've always had this knack for marketing. You know, you always kind of tie something to something to something to, you know, you just don't put out a song and cross your fingers. So when it came to putting the band together, you did that, you know, you can get into it, the thing with the CMT, and you had this show on the air, which was a great show. I loved it. And I've been, you know, I spent quite a while Googling to see if anything was on YouTube. Like, there's nothing. Like, I'd love to be able to see that. I'd love to be able to watch it again.
Me too. I actually just sent an email to Taylor Ellis, who is not with Chorus anymore, but he's the guy who made it all happen.
Okay.
And I asked him, you know, who could we talk to about getting this? You know, I've asked every once in a while, I kind of poke around to see, and it's kind of lost in some archive. I don't know where it goes, you know, swept under some sofa at Chorus, I guess, but I'd love to see it too. But it was a great time in history, and it was
really was.
You know, I kind of really felt free and unencumbered just to try. So, like, I was not. You always do everything with a little trepidation, I think, as an artist, to a degree, right? Like, you're like, well, maybe these guys won't like it. Maybe it won't work the radio. Maybe it won't. And I remember there was a block of like a year and a half, 2 years, where it was just like, I don't care. Like, this is what I'm doing, this, and this is great. It's just, I'm having a great time. This is my sandbox. Please come play if you want to. And if you don't, that's fine. And it's something that then once you have success, then you're like, oh, we got to do that again. And then it all falls in on you sometimes. It's just like, you can't do that, man. You got to, and I've been trying to get back to that point of feeling free. And it's not a matter of, it's not a money thing. It's not a political thing. It's nothing like that. It's all in your, it's in between your ears, right?
Yeah.
And that's important to get to. And it's neat seeing young artists come out because they're there for the most part, right? There's a lot they don't know and shouldn't know. And they're just having a great time. They're making their best thing. And it's a wonderful place to be. And I'm so glad that we got to put it on TV. And hopefully I can find a copy of that and watch it again.
Oh, yeah. please do. Because it's funny. Like, I guess it's like 15 years ago now. And, you know, it was magical because you had that show. And then you had this great album. And it just kind of took off. And, you know, a lot of the stuff was covers. You know, so it was just,
That's the thing about it. Like, you know, and I really felt bad about that. And then I started thinking about Dwight Yoakam. I'm like, it's kind of the same thing.
You're right. He did tons of covers. And, a couple of covers.
And like Clay, he always, he has the best, he coined the term, and he says, you know, we like to take out old classic songs and hammerize them. And I'm like, okay, that makes it cool. That's fine. Cause we're putting our stamp on it and it's good. And it's good because it goes back to the thing of, I don't care what anybody thinks. We're just like, this fits the record. It's not a matter of who wrote it or how many songs did you guys write? You know, it's just, this that's feels cool. Right.
Yeah, because I think most artists, I mean, myself included, if we're going to go in and do some recordings, we really feel like they got to be songs we wrote. Like it doesn't feel right to do a cover. But, you know, so many bands and artists really launched their careers with covers. I mean, it works. Yeah.
and some big ones, too. Even like David Lee Roth, like, you know,
you're right.
And stuff like that. Like, arguably one of his biggest, you know, solo record. Was it solo? Yeah, it was solo for him.
Yeah,
right?
Gigolo was solo.
Yeah, but I mean, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
But they were in the studio.
Pretty Woman did pretty good for Van Halen. Yeah. It's funny because I remember scenes. Like, I remember when you were auditioning Clayton and you're sitting around and you're playing Willen. Or mid 90s, I got really into Little Feet, and I was lucky enough. I caught them at Wonderland, I think, in the when the Let It Roll album came out. But
that was such a great track too.
Yeah, that was a great song. So when I saw that, that's why it sticks out in my head. I was like, "Holy shit, somebody's playing a Little Feet too. That's cool."
That was Chris Byrne. That was his idea because. I wasn't cool enough to know the intricacies of Little Feet other than, you know, roll. But I had that cassette, Let It Roll, and it was, I just loved that track.
That's it. There's a guitar player here in Toronto, John Fraser Lindley, incredible guitar player. And he has a Little Feet tribute band called Dixie Chicken. You know, what else?
Oh, that'd be great.
But he plays that stuff perfectly. He does the slide. He does the guitar, and he sounds like Lowell. Like it's pretty cool.
I don't know how those guys do it. You're born with that. You know what I mean? Like anybody can learn guitar, but there's a certain thing you're born with or not. And that's really stuff.
So there's one thing on there, because I a couple interviews ago I did the Danik Dupel from Emerson Drive. I don't know if it was just in my head or not, so you can maybe help me with this, because I was Googling it trying to find it, because I remember there was a scene in your series where you're doing these Nashville showcases, but you lost out to Emerson Drive. Is that in my head, or was that part of the series?
There was something where something happened where we lost out to Emerson Drive for something.
Yeah, okay, so I remember it right. Okay.
But it's hard to be mad at Emerson Drive because they're awesome. So.
Yeah, yeah. No, but I really wanted that clip to put in my video, in my interview.
I can't remember what that was. Yeah, something happened where, it was a record company. We were trying to get signed, and they had signed Emerson Drive, I think.
DreamWorks, something like that. Probably it was DreamWorks.
We already have a band from Canada or something, whatever it was. But I don't remember exactly what it was. But it's, you know, whatever. It's hard to be mad at those guys. They're good friends, and they're awesome.
So, yeah, so after Blood, Sweat, and Steel and Roadhammers 2, you know, the band took a hiatus. It was like, a 3-year hiatus. Now, was it planned that, we're just going to take a break and then we're going to get better? Or was there a possibility at that time that was kind of the end of it?
Could have been the end of Roadhammers. We were signed by a label called Montage, great bunch of people. Alan Butler was the head. He runs Sony and all these big labels. So we all moved to Nashville, 110%. We were all game on, ready to go. And then the label shut down and it got caught up in all this legal paperwork that we weren't allowed to record as the Roadhammers until the label released us, which lawyers and so litigious, they didn't do for a couple of years. And it just broke our hearts. And we were just like over it. You know, Clayton on, he did a solo record. I did the Everything record. And, you know, we just kind of had a real bad taste in our mouth with the whole thing. Yeah, we didn't know. Like, it could have been the end of the Hammers. And actually, Chris took a break from the band for a while. We had John Diamond come out and do a few shows where he was on bass. And
oh, cool.
We didn't know. Like, drummers, we were kind of... Corbett was in the band. And, Corbett was, in a lot of ways, the heart and soul of what we did. He was such a funny guy off stage, and he'd keep everything rolling and light on the road. It was really important.
Cool.
We didn't have that anymore. And now we got Steve Broadhurst, and I gotta tell you, he's just been wonderful. He's, he keeps it's something about drummers. They just keep everything light on the road and funny, and they are the heartbeat of a band in a lot of ways.
They gotta sit there and look at our asses all night. You know, they gotta have some sense of humor, you know.
Yeah. It's like, you know, it's not the greatest gig in the world, but for some reason, we're glad that they do it. So,
yeah, it's important.
it's super important. And drums. Like, you know, I'm not the best musician in the world, but I don't have the best timing in the world either, but for some reason, I'm really sensitive to poor drumming, you know, like, and not poor drumming.
Yeah. You know when it's not working.
Yeah, I don't, and sometimes I can't even articulate it. Like, I'm not that, you know.
You just know.
Yeah, and he's got it, man. He's just the best. He's simply the most comfortable I've been on stage with a drummer.
So we touched on this before a bit, but I'd love to drop some names because this is incredible. Yeah, so you went and did the album Everything, which I got to say, it's a great album. And who's ever watching this interview, if you haven't listened to it, just go on Spotify or whatever and listen to it. You know, it's got lots of great country shuffles. It's a great album. The musicians on this thing, it's incredible. Like, I got to do it. I got to drop names here. So, yeah, you had David Kalmusky, who we said he was on there. Actually included a video that you, when you were playing at the Grand Ole Opry, where he was playing on his video.
Yeah.
But the other guitar players, you had Brian Sutton. I mean, that's kind of the best for acoustic guitar. You know, Paul Chapman, Pat Buchanan. Rhythm section, Gary Craig and John Diamond and Greg Morrow, Michael Rhodes on bass. I mean, the guy plays with everybody. He's, you know, playing with Joe Bonamassa. And you had Reese Wyman, like the keyboard player for Stevie Ray Vaughan and Larry Franklin. Like, it's like, what a bang for the buck. Like, I can stream this thing for free. Like,
yeah,
I got to tell you.
It's amazing.
It's amazing. I went on AllMusic and I pulled down all the credits on that thing. And I was just like, holy shit. How did you get that all into a room?
Scott Baggett. That's how I got it in the room.
Oh, okay.
Scott Baggett's my conduit to everything. And Reese Wynans, here's the interesting thing. Reese played on Born Again in Dixieland too.
Oh, wow. So, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it wasn't my first, you know, meeting of him. He'd played on a couple of things before. He played on some solo stuff years ago. And I'm amazed when I look back at some of that stuff. It's amazing that you got the chance to be in the room. And it was also a time when I was learning and growing. Like, I didn't, you know, every time you get into a record, you know, you learn a bit and you grow a bit. But you know, I've grown a lot in the last 5 years even. And you kind of look back at what you were trying to instruct people to do in the studio, and you're like, they know what they're doing. Just let them do it. You know.
So were you there on the days they were tracking?
Oh yeah,
that's great.
I was a control freak. I used to be a super control freak about recording, and it's changed a lot actually. But everything was, you know, I was micromanaging everything, so it was kind of nice to let go of that at a certain point.
So do you recall, like, I mean, was this just like, you know, one take, two takes, next song, you know, like, I mean, because they're so good.
It is, to a degree, with those guys. They're kind of machines with emotion, you know, but they're so good. And I mean, they'll play it all day if you want to, but you don't have to. Like, you realize at a certain point, it's just like, wow, that's awesome.
That's cool.
What else you think is awesome? Oh, how about this? Yeah, it's awesome too.
Yeah.
It's picking what flavor of awesome you want.
So, and then fast forward into COVID, like I was saying earlier, you know, Ed Smith has them all on his front lawn.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, you know, people are walking by going, oh, wow, this is truly amazing.
Yeah. Actually, the last weekend I did see, because somebody had panned around, was walking around with their phone. The streets were pretty, pretty full. People had their lawn chairs out and everything. So he's got a really cool thing going.
That's good music.
Really good music. So on everything too, a lot of familiar songwriters were working with you on that. I see Odie Blackmon and Tom Shepard. Odie did a lot of stuff with Gary Allen, and Tom a lot of stuff with Craig Morgan, and probably lots of other people I don't know. But you've had quite a long relationship with those songwriters, eh?
Yeah, Odie's probably my oldest friend in Nashville, and I met him, not even sure how I met him, but I used to stay on his sofa, and we used to, you know, eat ramen noodles together and that kind of thing. And next thing you know, he got a couple of little cuts here and there, you know. But I'll never forget, he got a cut with Gary Allen. It was an album cut and stuff. But then he wrote George Strait's 50th number one song. It was his first big hit. First she's gonna come on strong.
Oh, I know that one.
Like she'll love you all night long. Like it's going out of style. Then she'll leave you with a smile. Killer. And just going from there. So, really great. Such a good songwriter.
Excellent. That was great. Thanks for that.
And Tom Shepard, Tom's a great guy. We wrote everything. We wrote I'd Rather Be Happy Than Right, which is one of my favorite songs. He wrote Redneck Yacht Club. And you know, he's
that's Craig Morgan, right? Redneck
Yacht. Yeah.
Good American tune.
Good American tune.
Good country American tune. America.
There's no I in America, son.
So the Hammers kind of got back together in 2013, and you put out the album Wheels and then Squeeze. So on Wheels, like we said earlier, you had that song Mud, which just went platinum. And you also had the tune I've Been Everywhere was off that album, which we've already kind of mentioned. So that was a good record. That was a good comeback record.
Very good record. And it was interesting because we kind of got to that place I was saying before where we didn't care too much, you know, and weren't thinking, weren't worried about radio, weren't worried about anything other than just making a really good Hammer record. And again, Scott Maggett being at the helm really helps keep that between the ditches, you know.
And I think, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but the big thing for the Hammers is the touring. I mean, I think when I was, well, we're the same age. So we were like, you know, late teens or something. It's kind of like you always knew it was summertime because you started seeing the posters for Kim Mitchell, you know. So I was like, oh, it's summertime. Right. Key Bella, or Kim Mitchell's, all right, let's go.
David Wilcox.
Yeah, or David Wilcox, right. So, but the Hammers became the Canadian summer thing. Like, oh, it's festival summertime, the Hammers are on tour, you know. It was like, so I think, you know, that was a big part of your success was those the shows and the energy of those shows.
Oh yeah, for sure. And Clay's, you know, a big part of that energy. And Chris, you know, he lays that blues angle down. I got the country thing. So it's a different sound live, you know, it's just, it's hard, you know, seeing what's going on this summer and no touring when that is really the heartbeat of what we do.
Yeah, you got to miss that because you guys look like you're having a ton of fun on stage.
Oh yeah, it's hard not to love that. It's like an A-bomb going off on stage, right? Like it's just there. Like we've all, like from Clay to Chris and I and Steve, we've all played in really great high level groups. You know, like with you know, the Johns, the Garys, and all that stuff. And those things click in a wonderful way. And even Clay's solo band Congregation, like it clicks in a wonderful way. There's something about that combination though. Like it's, I don't know what it is, but it happens. And it doesn't just happen, you know, once in a while, but it's there all the time. Like it's, the ingredients are there. Every time that in the oven, it comes out with that
thing. You see it. I mean, I've mentioned this to quite a few of my other guests when you're, cause your name kind of popped up quite a bit. That's why I wanted to reach out and get you on this. You know, whether I was talking to Kel Muskie or Jason Barrie, the thing we always kind of mention that, like, you're a great guitar player and you've got this ability. And this is what I want to ask, if you really have to work on it or it come natural, because you'll play like a lot of like pretty cool, like country runs and licks that were on the recordings, but you're running around when you do it. Like that floors me. And you don't really miss, you're not messing the stuff up. You're playing it. And is that like something that you really have to, well, listen, I haven't seen every single show you did, but is that something you really have to work at? Like just to nail the lick so good that you could run from this side to that side and not miss it.
You know what? We were afforded the wonderful luxury of doing a club tour early on that had like 40 shows right across the country. Okay. And then all through the States when we were doing all those radio shows, like we played nonstop for several years and it evolves, right? Like one night you're like, okay, during this solo, I run over here and when Clay's doing this and I run over here when Chris is doing that. And all of a sudden you pick and choose your battles. And then next thing you know, you're kind of training yourself to be able to do that. I think it evolves, but you know,
well, like anything, but it was something you were really focusing on.
I think there's some guys, like you watch Angus Young, right? And you're just like, that's the epitome of running around. I don't know what he does, if he jogs 50 miles a day or something to be able to do that. Cause I'll run around and then it would be like, okay, Clay's going to sing and this is my recovery time. Of thing, right? Deep breathing, Lamaze, remember your breathing. As you're playing the clubs and that, you kind of get used to how long the solos are and how far you can run in the audience and that kind of stuff.
Well, you do it good. It's fun. I think it was just some last summer. I remember seeing Peter and Patty there, the P&P people there. They were posting some stuff of you up at I forget what it was. It was some northern something Hollywood, not Hollywood, something.
Oh, Hollywood.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, yeah.
I was just doing the solo show there. It was fun. Actually, it was an interesting weekend because I did radio on Thursday. Flew out to France, played France.
That's right. You did a Hammerstein way out.
Friday night in France, and then I played Hollywood on Sunday or something like that, I was after radio Monday.
Yeah, that was great. Great plan and really entertaining. Anyway, moving on with the Hammers, I guess it was your last full album, Squeeze. And you had a really cool song on it. And I'll admit, I didn't really know the original of it. All Your Favorite Bands by the Dawes. And I wasn't familiar with that song, to be honest. But it was...
I wasn't either.
Oh, okay.
Clay heard it and he brought it in. We were recording with Gavin Brown at Noble Street in Toronto. We had a few songs to do. We didn't really have a ballad and we thought this would be a really cool thing to try. So
I like your version better, actually. I gotta admit it. I mean,
Well, thank you. One of the guys is married to like Gwyneth Paltrow or something. I don't know much about them, but they're kind of in that Hollywood scene, you know?
Oh, okay. And yeah, I don't know anything.
I just love the tune, and I'm so glad we cut it because we end the shows with a lot of the times. So it's kind of this epic statement, epic feel. You know?
No, I was going to make a joke there. I mean, for people who maybe don't know the song, the main lyric in the chorus is, may all your favorite bands stay together. So I kind of, you know, after recording that song, you can't really break up.
No. you can, but will you get back? Hey, you can't have a comeback if you don't break up.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Who's done that? I think it's, you know, Stones always had it.
Everybody.
Our farewell tour.
Farewell tour 275.
Yeah, wasn't that the steel wheels? They always joked it was like the wheelchair tour, but that was like in 1990, and that was supposed to be the farewell tour, you know. And
how they do.
And they were up at whatever it's called, the old Molson Park there last year, right?
Yep.
Unbelievable. And then I guess last year, this comes back to your marketing. I swear you've got a PhD in marketing, but you the Zamboni song. So, you know, the Hurricanes had to pull in an emergency goalie and he was the Zamboni driver. And you're like, let's do a song on that and we'll get Tim Hortons and the OHL to sponsor it. It's like, how'd you come up with that?
Well, that was getting the Tims and the OHL was my co-writer, Jim, who we wrote. That was his idea for the doing the We Are One. And so I said I wanted to write a song about Zambonis. And he owns the Barrie Colts in town here. He's a musician.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
And so we filmed it at his rink. And he's the one who had the friends with Tim Hortons. You know, it just all worked and all. It just all planned out. I didn't really. So.
My crazy little slip and slide.
So sometimes I've got a, it seems like when I really push for marketing things to happen, they don't really happen. But then when I just kind of let go a little bit, back to a whole control freak.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
When you let go, it just kind of happens. And I think the songs I try to write are fairly marketable and they're fairly broad.
Yeah. Like that's a marketable song.
It's funny though, with Zamboni, we got a cease and desist order from Zamboni.
Oh, did you?
They wanted us because they're very litigious. They don't want to lose the copyright on Zamboni like Kleenex. They don't want They wanted the song. They said you're only allowed to use this if you change the name of the song to Zamboni Ice Surfacing Machine.
that just rolls off the lips.
It was a lawyer. It wasn't them. They're great people, but it was a lawyer that, you know, was trying to be a lawyer. And it was just like, dude, this music, it doesn't happen like that. Yeah. So then we finally got a hold of the actual people and we worked it out, but it put the thing back way far in delays.
Oh man. I guess that doesn't surprise me, but that's
anyway, but it was pretty funny. Like now you can look back and laugh. At the time it was frustrating.
That is pretty funny. Anyway, it was pretty cool. You know, like you had this event, you come up with it, it's hockey, Tim Hortons. I mean, geez, it's going to work.
And, so, you know, I got the idea from going to hockey games and like, I just love that, you know, what's that Gary Glitter tune they always play?
Oh, yeah.
Rock and roll number or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
But anyway, so rock and roll part two or something.
Yeah.
So, I just like, if we're going to do a Zamboni song, that's got to be the groove, right? Yeah, Spirit in the Sky with, you know, Toms, right?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
It was fun. It was like knuckle dragon rock. It was great.
It was great. So what's up next for the Hammers?
Well, funny you should ask that. I have some vocals to sing. I'm the one holding up the train here. So okay. I've got a few things to sing on, and we've got a couple of tunes that are pretty close to getting ready to rock.
So we'll be seeing it soon. We'll be hearing it soon.
Yeah, it's different because it's not, you know, we're used to making albums and that's that whole, it's that really satisfying, I think, you know, thing of doing 10 songs and there's all different slots to fill and that. Now it's singles. So it's different world. But now we've got the songs in queue and I think we got some really cool stuff. So it's all gearing toward next year, you know, when the right release time is to get ready for touring season.
Cool. So you're doing your stuff in your own studio that you built?
Yeah, I got a little studio here to do some good vocals. I don't have a big studio. Like I always said right from the beginning, if I do anything recording, I just want to be able to record like two class A tracks and that's it. Cause I don't want to record drums. I don't want to do any of that stuff. There's studios that know what they're doing to do that.
I just do your own overdubs.
So if I need to record a guitar, If I need to do a vocal, great.
Yeah, but I'm not cool. Yeah, no, that's great. Yeah, drums, you kind of, that's really all, I mean, kind of that's all we really need big studios for now, you know, get the, you know, something with the high ceilings and all the mics and, you know, but all the other stuff, you don't really need a lot to record it.
A lot of the drummers, you know, have great setups, like, you know, in their homes, like Greg Morrow can record, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Beautiful master tracks in his home. It's that's who played cool. on We Are One. We sent it to him. He sends it back.
Yeah, I saw that. I remember seeing that clip. So, I mean, you've been holding this thing. This is what everybody sees you with. This, call this thing? National Resophonic. Is that right?
Yeah, Resoelectric.
Resoelectric, right.
Well, whatever. It's a hubcap of strings.
Yeah. So let's talk about it.
Yeah. Well, when the Hammers did our first record, it was Brian Sutton who played the resonator on all that Hammer stuff. And so he played all that. All that stuff.
Yeah.
And so he played it on like an acoustic resonator, but we mic'd it up and we kind of gacked it up to sound really, you know, funky. And so I needed to find something. I tried all different versions of guitars to play live, but with a resonator specifically, because it's got that cone in here.
Yeah.
It vibrates and then it howls, you know, through the monitors and the big PA so readily, right? It's hard to get anything that works. And this is what, you know, Colin Linden always played. He played the fiberglass version of these for the most part.
Okay.
And I went down to the 12th fret one day in Toronto and found this. It was just hanging there. It was new. And I just fell in love with it right off the bat. And I couldn't really take it and try it out, but I had a couple of fairly big shows coming up. And I just... It just, you plug it in and it's got your regular plug in and it's got a piezo and it's got a P90 and you got, you know, switch between the two. I just blend it right in the middle, volume up, and then you got your individual volumes and it's just awesome. It's like the Chevrolet guitars. Like it always does what it's supposed to do, you know?
So most of the time you're playing with it blended between the P90 and the.
Yeah. I just put it through a DI and then we funk it up through the front of house and I just throw it back through the monitors. I don't do much to it at all.
Oh, cool.
And the cool part about it is that it's bulletproof. I mean, I've had to put a new neck on. It's got a two-way truss in it. Oh. And we played so much all through the U.S. and everything. It just got, you know, just condensation and just moisture, and the neck just got funky. Got some rust in the truss rod from sweating so much on stage.
Yeah.
And so we had to replace the neck. But I just love the guitar. Like, everything about it's great. The microphone's really cool, too, if you throw a mic kind of like right around the bridge, or if you throw a mic, maybe, you know, even 12, something like that. It's got the characteristics between micing the 12 fret and the hubcap are astounding. Like you can do a lot with it and then record a line, and then you can put like an amp modeler through it and just kind of funk it up a little bit.
Well, that's great. Yeah. You've been known to have that one around you for quite a while.
Yeah. Everybody thinks it's really old guitar, but I mean, like it's been, you know, I cleaned it up a little bit here, but all the finish is being worn off from sweat and stuff. But other than that, it's in really great shape. And for the amount that's, you know, we've traveled, it's got a little beat up on it, but belt buckle rash. But it's a 2000. So that was when it was built.
So do you have a backup when you tour, or that's it? Like you break a string and you go to something else?
Sometimes, more than once, I do carry an extra cone because more than once... Wow. The airline, you know, if they drop the case, it will just hit these strings hard enough that it'll pop the cone inside.
Oh, wow.
And it's thin aluminum. But other than that, it's been bulletproof electronically. And I got to just say, like, anytime I call the national folks in California, if I need any parts or anything like that or support, they're like the best. It's really, it's fun too, because it's really thin and narrow. So if you're writing songs with it, like,
yeah, it's
no matter what you do, it sounds cool, right? G chord. It just sounds. It just sounds cool.
Well, yeah, it's a lot louder than a Tele unplugged. That's for sure.
That's the other thing. It's pretty loud too. So when I am writing songs with people, it can get a little annoying. I have to know my.
So what's your number two?
Number two. Well, my Tele. I've had it. I bought it. Up in Penetang, actually, through what was the Simcoe Shopper at the time. It's like Kijiji on paper.
Yeah.
I bought it. It was perfect shape.
That's the Sunburst one you play with?
Yeah, a Telecaster, the Sunburst one. And it was in perfect shape and I was keeping it that way. And I was actually at the 12th fret getting it set up. And I walked out onto the street there. What are they on?
Danforth Street.
They're on the Danforth. Yeah, that's right. So I had a gig bag on my back and it was kind of an old one. And it was like, my dad was saying, oh, you better get that, replace that zippers going. And I was, you know, dum-dum-dum-dum. So I threw it on my back after getting it all fixed up and the zipper let go and it went all the way down the sidewalk onto the gutter and like in between cars. So it was all beat up. And after that, it's, I don't care anymore. It's all scratched and it's kind of a fun thing to see how many scratches it gets.
It's a road hammer guitar now.
My number two acoustic is this J45, nice. Which I just love. Just love the sound of it. It's a great guitar. It's country, man. You can't beat a J45. So it's a great one.
What year is that? Is that a vintage or a relatively?
We rented this for a radio tour for the Squeeze record.
And then you're just like, I like it. I'll take it.
Yeah. And it's hard with acoustics. Like, you don't know until you really get out and play with them a few times.
Yeah, right? Sure. So do you prefer the Gibson tone on the acoustic versus a Martin? Pretty distinctly different.
At times. Like the Martin, I've never owned a Martin, but I sure love them when I hear them.
Yeah.
Not owned a Martin for any particular reason, but I would love to. But I have a Taylor as well. I have a Taylor 410.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I got that.
The Taylor.
Did you say 410?
Mm-hmm.
Just before we got married as a gift, my wife bought me a Taylor 410. And then stupidly, I traded it about 4 years later for something else, and I can never live it down. It gets brought up all the time.
Right.
So
right.
Out there, if you have a wonderful wife that loves you and she buys you a guitar, never trade it.
That's right. Never trade it. No, that's true.
Well, it was a 410.
I love this thing right from the beginning, but I find the Taylor is so pretty. It's almost like it's like artificial sweetener. It's like if you use it too much, you kind of get, you kind of little much, you know?
Yeah.
But, the Gibson has it sounds like a country
it's
guitar.
It's got a distinct sound, The Taylor's got to have a brighter tone to it.
Yeah,
they're pretty. They're beautiful guitars. Yeah, great. If we could, let's touch on amps. What's, are you doing more of the fractal axe effects thing, or do you have amps on stage?
Amps. Cool. I've always wanted to get into the Kemper kind of thing, and I just never, I'm a horrible programmer. I don't know what I'm doing.
Yeah, I've been shying away from it too. It scares me.
Guys like Danik and Jason Barrie and that, I don't know. They just know what they're doing. Yeah. And I call them every few years and I just annoy the heck out of them because I ask their opinion. Cal Muskie too. So what should I get? Well, this is how this works. This is what this does. Where do you plug the distortion in before or after the delay, you know? And so I am a, I was into AC30s for a while.
Okay.
But I'm into the blues, is it the DeVille or the 410s, whatever, which one that is?
Oh yeah, like the basement, whatever.
Basement, yeah. They work too.
Yeah.
Or whatever, but any 410 kind of amp combo works for me. But cool. I like the Brad Paisley kind of tone, but I never achieve it. And I have a love-hate relationship with the Tele because I don't like my Tele and I never have. And everybody knows that. It sounds like a mosquito to me when other guys' Teles sound so beefy. You know, I want that beefy Tele tone.
Yeah, it's hard, right? It's either a little ear piercing or then you get it too dark and then you can't really hear yourself playing.
Yeah, like those 70s Teles, the black ones with the four knobs, and they're always weigh about 100 pounds, you know. And those, all the rock guys play them, they sound great. But I went so far as to buy one of those mahogany Teles that have the body through neck, you know.
Oh,
the one. And I had it all hopped up with electronics that were, I thought were more Gibson-y and everything, and still sounds like a Tele.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, the old thing, like I want fat tone and I play a Tele. It's like, well, you can't have both, right? So you gotta deal with it.
Okay, so you're mostly like, you said the 410, so like a basement or a super or that kind of, that's your setup. And what about pedals? I mean, you don't strike me as a big pedal guy, but what's your
basic setup? I've got delay pedals that I've got a couple of them. I got the El Capistan.
I have
one, so I got one. And we were in a pedal war for a while. And and then I got the Timmy pedal for the Overdrive Vibe. I liked it. And then I got an OCD, the white one. Yeah. And I got, it sounds like the Marshall modeler, yeah, you know?
Been around forever.
High and low pass filter. So I like that. I keep the low pass on all the time. And it's pretty good for those really beefier songs, but it's still that telly thing, right? And that's where that rub comes all the time for me. But I keep a fairly aggressive overdrive on all the time. And that OCD will be a second on just to really saturate it. And then I got Stuart Cameron hooked me onto Union pedals. And I got the red one, whatever it's called. It just makes everything bigger and brighter. It's just a boost is all it is. But it's a big
kind of like the RC booster exotic.
Yeah. It's great. I don't know what it is, but it just, you set your tone, you love it, and then you just hit this thing and the world just lights up. It's wonderful.
I'll look it up. Cool.
I forget the name of it right now, but I can't say enough about it. It's like everybody who's around, they're just like, what is that? You know, as soon as you turn it on, you see all the crew kind of like, you know, I thought this was going to suck, but I think it's going to be okay. And that's a Canadian made product. It's the best.
Oh, it's Canadian. Oh, okay. Great. Yeah,
they're out in Vancouver.
Oh, great. Do you practice a lot? Like the actual, like doing licks and electric kind of stuff?
I did. I haven't for quite a while. You know, we haven't been playing this year. And so when we usually I'd ramp up for the season, I'd get, you know, back up to speed. But with radio, I haven't been playing much at all. The guitar sits in the corner, which is a shame because, but you know, it's like after a certain amount of years, it is like riding a bike, but you haven't progressed. So you got to remember you're not. But I intend to, like, I'm kind of getting, my headspace is getting a little more musical again, go through seasons.
Yeah. Well, listen, you've been doing it a long time, so you deserve a break if that's what you want, right?
If that's what you want.
Listen, it's been, I got to thank you so much for being part of this. You know, so many of my guests were guys that played with you, kind of a little behind the scenes, but you're kind of like the front guy, so it's kind of cool to have a guest that females even know.
So, yeah, right. Those guys are like the best. I mean, I continue to learn so much from them, and they were talent beyond what I deserved in my camp, and it was just wonderful.
Well, I'm sure they all enjoyed playing with you. Yeah, you really did have some great players. So, man, thanks again, and listen, I can't wait to see one of your shows again sometime. Hopefully soon.
It'd be great to see you in person for sure, and I thank you for doing this because it's a great series. Thank you very much.
All right. Cool, man. Thanks, man.
If you're still watching, that must mean you really enjoyed this video. A huge thanks goes out to Jason McCoy for taking the time to chat with me today. I know it's not easy for him being a radio show host. He's up at 3 a.m. This has been my 17th episode, so a huge thanks goes out to all my guests that have participated so far. I'm truly having a blast doing this during these difficult times. Please subscribe, hit that bell notification button, leave a comment. I'd love to hear from you. I should have another video out in about a week's time. So until then, take care and bye.